Nebo, are you ready?
Never ready.
Say nebo.
Nebo.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Turn on the other side, ask the other nebo again.
Nebo.
Are you ready? Say nebo.
Nebo.
Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Say nebo.
Nebo.
Are you ready? So just look at me.
After this service,
you will not recognize me again. Say never.
After this service,
you will not recognize me again. If that means if that prophecy is for you, can I hear a joyful hallelujah? Part 2. Not so. Tell your neighbor today is part 2. That today will not pass me by. Today is my day to celebrate. Whether you like it or not,
my page is open.
My brothers and sisters, those that are sitting down should stand on their feet. Yes. Honor grace. This is a moment with Jesus' joy and a shout of an offering that you have never given. Yes. You come as you welcome Reverend Etta Peter on the altar.
The privilege to stand here this fateful day to share the word of God with us. I'm grateful for the man of God, your father, your pastor, that God has placed over you. Use you to show him I want you to put your hands together for the sacrifice and for everything God is using him to do. I also want you to appreciate your mother, the wife who is standing by him. Most wives of men of God are pastors to the men of God. We come to pastor you or minister to your needs. There's another person that minister to our own needs. But we have all the blows and the headache for managing this church of God. When we get home, maybe we are stressed or we are distressed. Somebody else minister to us. It is not easy to find a woman that supports your dream. It is not easy to find a woman that supports your vision and your calling. I've been opportune to be around men of God, women of God, and I can tell you their challenges for my few years in ministry. And I want you to put your hands together for this woman. A leader doesn't talk down, a leader talks up. A leader talks at this level or talks up. The pastor will never come and tell you that it's not working. Because you are coming to the pastor to tell the pastor it's not going. If the pastor tells us, as you see, we all know what can. You will run out of this church. You understand it? It's the truth I'm telling you. A leader never talks down. They talk up. And sometimes the best friend they talk to outside God and the Holy Ghost is their spouse. And maybe their spiritual parent. There is no man of God that doesn't face crisis. There is no man of God without certain levels of challenges. And so, the wives of men of God are pastors to the men of God. Physical elements of exaltation to them. And then nothing becomes so worse if you have the ones that are more trouble to you. It's the reason why many men of God are running away from ministry or having serious problems in ministry. Say better in me.
Amen.
Can we read Mark chapter 2? Title this message, Understanding the House of God. Title it what? Understanding the House of God. Understanding the House of God. Understanding is the key for producing certain results in life. Understanding, if you enter ministry without having the right understanding about ministry, you will not produce the desired results that ministry requires. If you hurry and get married without having the right understanding about marriage, you won't be fall below expectation in the matrimonial institution. You will one day fall out of place or fall out of course. You one day fall out of marriage. As many are who jumped in and now finding their way out. A few hours ago, I was showing one of my brother a text that a lady wrote to us and is telling us she's tired of marriage. She's tired about life. And she wants an exit. There is nothing you're going to do in this life without understanding. Anything you do in this life void of accurate and sound understanding, you risk landing into error. And today our primary focus is understanding what? I'm not getting you. What is our focus? I'm going to pick a text to really talk to us this day. And when I pick the text, we are going to explore the text in a high explorative manner, and at the end of the day Everyone will find their place. And everyone will be able to move to a higher level.
Amen.
In the house of God.
Amen.
Say better in it.
Amen.
Are you in Mark chapter 2? Can we stand to the honor of the reading of God's word? The people here are going to read the first verse. This way. The people here will read the second verse. The people here will read the third verse. I will read the fourth verse. You will read the fifth verse. They will read the seventh verse. And then you will read the eighth verse. Are you there? And I'll read the ninth verse. So number one, can we go?
Jesus went into the temple, and the news of his arrival spread quickly through the
temple.
Verse 2.
And straightway many were gathered together,
insomuch that they were not able to receive them, nor so much about them, and preach the word unto them.
No. Verse 3. Verse 4. They couldn't bring him to Jesus because of the crowd. Someone say because of the crowd.
Because of the crowd.
So they dug a hole through the roof above his head. Then they lowered the man on his mat right down in front of Jesus. This rule, verse 5.
Seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, "My son, your sins are forgiven."
Middle row, verse 6.
But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts.
Next row, verse 7.
I was this man, not speaking in blasphemous, who can forgive sins, but not.
Okay, leave it for me. Verse 8. Jesus knew immediately what they were thinking. So he asked them, "Why do you question this in your heart?" Verse 9. Is it easier to say to the paralyzed man, "Your sins are forgiven," or "Stand up, pick up your mat and walk"? So I will prove to you that the Son of Man has the authority on the earth to forgive sins. Then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, "Stand up, pick your mat, go home." And the man jumped out, grabbed his mat, and walked through the stoned onlookers. And they were all amazed and praised God, exclaiming, "We have never seen anything like this before." That is what is going to be your story soon.
Amen.
We have never seen anything like this before. There is a miracle God is going to do to you this year, 2020.
Amen.
And people around you will say, "We have never seen." I'm not hearing your voice that you're preaching with me.
Amen.
There are miracles that happens to you that others have seen, people have seen, and there is a miracle that happens to you that people have never seen it before. The person with the loudest amen, 5 months from today, that kind of miracle will land on your hand. It will land on your family. Right now, where your family is, it looks like a play issue. 5 months from today, there is a good news coming to your house. I want all of us together to read verse 1. I'll read on two verses. The King James, I'll read on two different versions of the Bible. The King James puts it this way. And again, he entered campaign. After some days, and it was noise that he was in the house. Someone say, "In the house."
In the house.
What is my message?
In the house of God.
And it was what?
In the house.
That he was
in the house.
In the house. New Living Translation puts it this way. When Jesus returned to Capernaum several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back home. He heard his team named back home. That means he was out of home. Did you see that? He was where?
Back home.
That means he was
out of home.
He was out of home. Almighty Father, help us to the glorification of your word. Guide us with utterance and clarity of speech. Make my mouth a pen writer today to inscribe truths in the hearts of men. And at the end of the day, let these truths produce faith, and let faith produce action, and let action produce miracles, and let miracles produce testimonies.
Amen.
And let the doors open for someone who has come here with a longing, with a hunger, with a thirst in their spirit to meet with you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Can we be seated? You permit me to come down from the pulpit small. At least we have read the word gradually. The first thing is that the house of God is called Bethel. Bethel means the house of God. Bethel means the house of God. And as a child of God who is part of the house of God, you must understand that there is what is called the house of God. There is what is called the physical house of God. And the building where we are in the physical house of God. And there is what is called the mobile house of God. Bible says your body is the house of God. The residence where God dwells. The residence of the Spirit of God. Everywhere people of God gather, Bible says, wherever two or three will gather in my name, I will be in their midst. Therefore, what is the house of God? The gatherings of the saints. Another way you can define the house of God, it simply means the gathering of the saints, the gathering of the people of God. What is the preacher speaking? Understanding the house of God. Like I said, the house of God means better. The physical house of God, like you see buildings, started in the days of Solomon. Because Solomon was the first to build the house of God. God never dwelt in any house. God dwelt in tents. Moses was the first man to build what is called the tabernacle. According to Exodus chapter 25. And when the Israelites were moving in the wilderness, they carried what? The tabernacle. And they were also doing what? Moving. Not so? They were moving. Why they walk, they walk. In other words, that's what I talk about, the mobile house. As they are moving, they are also moving with the house of God. And that's why when you grow in theology, We have different things. We talk to you about the characteristics of the house of God. That the house of God is not stagnant. Any house that you see is stagnant, God is not inside. Because God is always on the move. Am I speaking to somebody here?
Yes.
Why they carry the ark of the covenant, they were moving. In the days of Joshua, the priest carries the ark and they moved. At the temple of Shiloh in the days of Samuel, there was a small place set like a tent. And in that place, the ark of covenant was resident there. When Samuel, Hannah, the mother of Samuel, needed a child, she went to that house and cried. And when she came to that house and cried, barrenness was uplifted from her.
Amen.
God gave her a fruit of the womb. Isn't it? Huh? Later on, Israel made an error through the sons of Eli, and the Ark of the Covenant was captured. And they gave birth, the wife of one of the sons of Eli gave birth when the Ark of the Covenant was captured. The name is named Ichabod, which means the glory has departed from Israel. What does that connote? It means in the house of God, there is the glory of God.
Amen.
Remember, they said that it was a news that Jesus returned. That means he was out. The glory was out of Israel. The glory was out. The glory was out. So there is a possibility to have a house that the glory has left. It's possible to be in a church where God is not there. It's possible to be in a church where there is no glory in that church. And God does not just go out of a church like that. The glory of God does not just go out of a church like that. The glory of God does not just go out of a place. It is man and the activities of that place that causes God to go out of the place. I'm taking time to lay a foundation so that we can go to our text. The first thing I'm trying to establish is that in the house of God, it is possible for the glory to go out. And when you lost the glory, you have lost everything. If you miss God, you have missed everything. And the trend continues until Saul came to power as the first king after the judges. And then David came to power. And then Solomon came and built the house for God. And then the house now came as what we call a physical structure, like what we're inside today. Am I talking to somebody?
Yes.
As what? A physical structure. What makes the strength of every house is the God of the house. I've started. And the more we. And the God of the house is called El Beter. Remember, I told you that Beter means the house of God. El Beter means the God of the house. El Beter. E-L hyphen Beter. El Beter means the God of the house. You can come to the house of God and don't know the God of the house. You can be in church and don't know the God of the church. You can be in the house of God and still yet don't know God. Zion Ministry. When Jesus returned or came back to Campania, the news spread quickly that he was in the house. Somebody say, in the house.
In the house.
You came to the house of God to know Jesus. What makes the strength of the house of God is the presence of Jesus. Every church is mandated to present Jesus to the audience. Jesus is the subject of our message. Jesus is the one who died. In Acts chapter 4 verse 12, he says, there is no name that is given unto men through whom or which we shall be saved. But what? The name of Jesus. You came to the house of God to know Jesus. Every house that will lift up Jesus will spread quickly. And there was news that Jesus was in the house and it spread quickly. If this church has to spread, it needs to present Jesus. Am I speaking to somebody here?
Yes.
If this ministry will need to spread radically until there will be crowds out there, if we present Jesus to the audience, do you know why the news spread? Do you know why people gathered as we were reading the verses? Because Jesus was where?
Yeah.
I'm not getting you why.
Yeah.
Is it because another human being was in the house?
No.
Huh?
No.
It's because who was in the house?
Jesus.
I want to hear you better.
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 Jesus.
If we as a church lift up Jesus in this house, what will happen? What will happen? What will happen? The people come. Why should you come to the house of God? I'm asking you, why did you come to the house of God? Why should you come here? Why should you be part of this ministry? What is the responsibility of the church? Is to represent, project, exalt, elevate Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Our responsibility is to help those who come in here to know Jesus. Our responsibility is to help those who come here to be saved. We point them the cross. There was one man. He was God that became flesh. Took the form of a man. His incarnation. Went to the cross of Calvary. Was crucified and died for the sins of humanity. Went to hell and was on the grave for 30 days. Resurrected. And is now seated at the right hand side of the Father. Someday he's going to come back. And we are here to prepare a generation that will be caught up with him to his glorification. Everything centers about his coming, his going to the cross, his death, his burial, his resurrection, and his coming back. Do you believe he's coming back? Do you believe he's coming back?
Yes.
Am I speaking to somebody here?
Yes.
The house of God is a preparatory house to prepare the saint for the second coming of our Lord Savior, Jesus Christ. We are preparing the people. We are preparing an army. This place is here to prepare people. Am I speaking to somebody here? In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You came to the house of God not to see a man. You came to know Jesus. Somebody say Jesus.
Jesus.
Why are you here? You came to know Jesus. You came to be saved by Jesus. You came to be redeemed by Jesus. You came to understand the ways, the life, the principles of Jesus. Because Jesus is the head of the church.
Am I talking to somebody here?
Yes.
Are you hearing me better?
Yes.
Once this focus is tampered with, we will lose him in the house. Once this objective is tampered with, you know why people easily leave the church? Jesus wasn't their focus. I'm going somewhere. You know why people easily leave the church? You know why they easily leave the ministry? Jesus was not at the center of their motives. It was not their reason why they came to the house of God. That's number one. You came to the house of God not for man, and therefore man should not take you out.
Yes.
I'm moving somewhere, you're not getting me. You get there. Who brought you to the house? Why did the people gather? Because Jesus was in the house. They came because of Jesus, and therefore they cannot go because of man. You didn't hear it.
Yes, sir.
I said you didn't hear it.
Yes, sir.
You come to the house of God because of Jesus. You came because of God, and therefore never allow man to take you out.
Yes, sir.
I have said it many times for all my years in the Lord. There is no human being that will take me out of God. My convictions are too strong for a man to uproot me out of the faith. Have you seen people give you the reason why they leave the church? Have you seen people give you the reason why they leave the house of God? If you're wise, you're intelligent, if you scant, the reason is subject to man. The reason why they are going out is because of what? Man. It's because of man. It's because of somebody. It's because of maybe a brother, maybe a sister, maybe this one, maybe this one. It is always a reason, trace connected to a man. That is the reason why you go out of the house of God. I present a solution to you. You came to the house of God because of who?
Jesus.
And it should be Jesus that should take you out of the house. It should never be a man to take you out of the house. Am I talking to somebody else?
Yes.
I came here to know God, and I came here to serve God, and I came here to live for God till the time that He will come back again. Okay, that is established. Your primary focus for the house of God is to see Jesus, to know Jesus, to be part of Jesus' service, working for Jesus. Why are you sweeping the church? I'm sweeping it for Jesus. Why are you dry cleaning the hall? I'm dry cleaning the hall for Jesus. Why do you give your money into church? You gave your money because of what? Because of your love for Jesus. Everything I'm doing it for Jesus. Because someday, if man does not appreciate you, you'll get offended. You know why people leave? They said, nobody even bother what I did. If you did it for man, you seek for appreciation for man. Appreciation for man. But if you did it for God, Bible says, he who sees in the secret knows how to reward you in the open. If you did it for Jesus, there is surely a day that the reward will come publicly. Many might think you're a fool, but you're not a fool. You did it for Jesus. Man may not see it, but Jesus. What did I say?
Man may not see it,
but Jesus. That's what? I am in the house of God for Jesus. I am in the house of God to see Jesus. I am in the house of God to please Jesus. I am in the house of God to know Jesus. Did you hear the grammar? I am in the house of God for Jesus. I am in the house of God to see Jesus. I am in the house of God to know Jesus. I am in the house of God to please
Jesus.
Jesus. The first character we had was Jesus. Hold your Bible. The second character we had was a paralyzed man in the text. The third character we had was the four men that carried the paralyzed man. The next character we had was the crowd. The men could not penetrate the paralyzed man because of what? The crowd. And the last character we had was the religious leaders. First, Jesus. Second, the paralyzed man. Third, the four men that carried the paralyzed man. Fourthly, the crowd. Fifthly, the religious leaders. There are five persons in the text. And all these five persons are in the house of God. Were all of them involved in the house? Huh? Were all of them involved in the house? That's what I came this today to teach. Five distinguished characters in the house of God. Jesus, the paralyzed man, dysfunctional man, unable to walk, unable to do things by his own self, and needs the support of other people. The crowd, who is there to block people who wants to see Jesus. Oh, you are not getting me, 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 you are not getting me. Is it possible to be in the house of God and yet you are blocking people not to see God?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You will be with me, isn't it? Or is one in you? They were struggling to bring the paralyzed man to see Jesus. And they themselves were struggling to see Jesus, but they could not because of the crowd. So let's start with, therefore, the house of God is not a perfect house. If you are looking for a perfect church, wait after rapture. I'm sorry to disappoint you. The house of God is like the hospital you see in my wine, the original hospital. All kinds of people are inside. The church will be a perfect church only after rapture. If you are looking for a perfect church, wait after rapture. Did you see the five characters I just listed? One is unable to walk. Others are able to walk. Some are just in the crowd. Some are just there to be criticizing. The house of God is not a perfect place. Instead, the house of God is mandated to perfect the imperfect people that comes in. Is it not written? He that ascended, descended is he that ascended. And he gave this gift, the apostle, the prophet, the pastors, sorry, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teacher, fivefold ministry, for the perfecting. If they were perfect, why are they perfecting them? For the perfecting of the saints. What is the job of the fivefold? To perfect the saints. So God cannot ask you to perfect what is already perfected. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes,
are you sure you're hearing me better?
Yes.
God will never allow you to perfect what is already perfected. God knows that people are going to enter the house of God with different struggles, different areas of their life they are struggling with. And then when they come, through the ministry of the word and different things, there will be going through transformation. That's what the Bible says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. Somebody say transformed.
Transform.
Say again, say transformed.
Transform.
The house of God is a transformational ground. It's a ground that transforms people. is a ground that receives any kind. Are you a thief? Come. Are you a prostitute? Come. Are you a liar? Come. Whatever kind of life you have lived before, the house of God is open for you to come. And when you come, the power in the blood of Jesus, the power in the word of God, will be able to transform that bad habit, that bad way of life, that kind of life you're living. And then before you discover, you start singing the song. I no longer do the things I used to do. I no longer walk in the path I used to walk. I'm no longer the same person I used to be. Am I talking to somebody here?
Yes.
Because Jesus Christ is a transformer. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
My daughter, please can you see this way? You see this way. Okay, look like that. When she see it, you see. Please permit me. Let me just interrupt your structure a little. Please tell my daughter. I need somebody who masters my administration. Amen. And you back up from there.
I'm no longer a slave.
are permitted to come to the house of God the way you are, then you are not permitted to stay the way you came. If you are a thief, we want to see the change. If you are a liar, we want to see the change. The house of God is a ground of transformation. The objective of God is to see that the fivefold perfect the saints. The word perfect means participate in the transformations of the saints. The word perfect means participate in investing godliness in the people. People are coming to the house of God, they don't want to change. And that's why we sing the song, I'm no longer the same person I used to be. I'm a child of God now. I'm a child of God. I'm fighting for transformation. I used to have anger. But oh God, this anger is not good. I used to have a life of disrespectfulness. There is something that has to change. I talk to people very rudely. Can you really see your being transformed? Are you humbling yourself to be transformed? Have you humbled yourself for the word of God to have his way in your life? Someone in the crowd. Number one, they are always in the general opinion. They don't have a say and a stand for themselves. They don't have a say or a stand for themselves. They are always dancing in the opinion of the crowd, the general. General opinion. As I don't talk anymore. When you talk, say, wait, see. No, they don't really talk about. I think when they talk, they don't talk about. Let everybody, can we contribute to 2,000? They say 2,000. I definitely. I told you I'm coming small, small, right?
Okay.
Huh? General, they are general managers. They're always general affairs. You can't actually find where they belong and what they stand for. It's one of the characteristics of those where? In the house. Where? I'm not getting where?
In the house.
You're going. Number two, characteristics of the crowd. They hinder other people to see Jesus. they hinder other people to access Jesus. If a new member walk into this church and meet someone who is in the crowd, that person in the crowd will cause that person to backslide. The person that was coming has a genuine motive to see Jesus, but your way of life caused the person not to see Jesus. Because only the way you talk, your mouth will drive people who want to see Jesus. Some of us just were dressed inside. Dressing style in the house of God is enough to send people not to see Jesus. Your best dressing is when you're in the house of God. When you walk into that street, you're a different person. If we see you, we cannot differentiate whether you were the sister we saw on Sunday or you're one of the prostitutes we see in the church today. You are a hinder to those who want to see Jesus. Now, may I write down? Am I the only one?
No.
I'm interpreting the scriptures. As I said, make my mouth a pen writer to interpret the scriptures in the heart of me. In Luke, Gospel chapter 19, verse 1, 2, 3, 4, there was a man very short in stature. His name was Zacchaeus. He ran to see Jesus, the crowd. The crowd. So he could not see. The crowd has a characteristic to cause people not to see Jesus. May I ask you a simple question today? Are you in the crowd? Maybe that might not be better. Have you been in the crowd all this while? In the house of God. Have you been able to put your back for people to climb and see Jesus? Or you've been an obstacle for men who want to see Jesus and they are not able to see him? Have you been the reason why people are walking out of churches from the house of God? Have you been the reason why people are walking out of the house of God? They came to see Jesus, but you sent them out. You blocked them. They want to know what are the principles in the house of God. What are the principles of Jesus? What are the life of Jesus? What they want to know Jesus. The way on how to follow Jesus. They say, no, that one no believer. That one no practicer. That one some no believer. The way you talk, spoil people when they want to know Jesus. Can I make it better? You sure you're ready?
Yes,
there's a scripture called in Luke chapter 18, verse 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, right up to verse 40. It's a story of a blind man who sat at the wayside begging. And hearing that Jesus of Nazareth passed by with the crowd, he said, they asked, who passed by? They told him, Jesus of Nazareth passed by. When he shouted, the crowd told him, shh. You are not getting it. What did the crowd tell him? Shh. He wants to see Jesus. He wants to go. The crowd told him what? I don't know if I'm seeing the characters of the crowd. Are you among those who are people are trying to see Jesus? You silence them. They want to manifest. They want to operate in the gifting. Are you among one of those people in the house of God that young people are struggling to see Jesus? They are paralyzed. They are blind. But they know if they meet Jesus, they can see. They are trying to use other angles of their giftings like their mouth. And what are you doing? Please, can you move to 15 people? Say, are you making shh in church? My children want to be so serious for God. People want to learn how to preach. You're making. They are learning to prophesy. You're making. The crowd silenced the zeals of people. The crowd silenced what? The zeal of people in the house of God. The crowd. My brother is turning the text. He said, why is this man preaching it? He's preaching it. I'm teaching it. So I'm teaching that side of it. The crowd silenced the gift. The house of God is supposed to identify gift, nurture the gift, decorate the gift, and project the gift. Identify giftings in people, develop it, nurture it, project it. Project it. But instead today, we are struggling to do what? Shh, silence it. Because envy, strife, jealousy, what do? You are not hearing me. Say the crowd.
The crowd.
So can I ask you a question? Are you among the crowd? Or have you been in the crowd? Because as I'm teaching, I'm curing it immediately. What does Zacchaeus do to escape the influence of the crowd? He ran and overtook the crowd. Did he allow the crowd to stop him?
No.
Did he?
No.
The text we read, did the people allow the crowd to stop them?
No.
Did they allow it?
No.
The man in Luke chapter 18, the blind man, did he allow the crowd to stop him?
No.
What did he do? He shouted them all. Can I speak to someone?
Yes.
If you give an excuse in the last day that it was the crowd that made me not to know you, Jesus would quote those people I just quoted now in the Bible. He said, look at this man. They had crowds, but they were able to see me. Zacchaeus would say, I was very short in stature, you are tall in height than me. But I still did not allow the influence of the crowd to stop me. Never allow anybody in the house of God to stop you from seeing God.
Amen.
I'm speaking with all authority and boldness. Never allow anybody to stop you from seeing God. Keep being zealous. Keep moving. The crowd is one of the reasons many people have ended where they ended. The crowd is the reason why many people have not gone far in their walk with God. The crowd is the reason why many people have not known God in an intimate and deeper level. And the apostle Paul said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Philippians chapter 3 verse 10. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection. I may know him, I may see him, I may know him and the power of his resurrection. And the power and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Ghost. And the sweet fellowship of the Holy Ghost and the fellowship of his suffering. Am I speaking to somebody here?
Yes.
For now, let's leave the crowd. At least I'll give you some few points for the crowd. The next point is the religious leader. The religious leader. What do I say? The religious leader symbolizes the leadership. Those who know a little thing about God. Those who understand certain things about prophecies. Those who are like, some of them are serving in leadership positions in the house of God. That account is coming on verse 6 and verse 7. Hear what they said. But some of the teachers of religious law, who were sitting there, they were not outside. They were in their house seated. Can I ask you a question? They were not outside, they were seated in the house. And when Jesus spoke, the word of God came, hear what they said in the sermon. What is he saying? this is blasphemy. Only God can forgive. Am I talking to somebody here? That's the next people you're going to meet in the house of God. You're going to meet some people in the house of God. And this one I'm addressing those who are leaders of this house. You are in the bench of leadership. You are in the role of leadership in the house of God. The first thing is that, number one, they challenge the message. Why does he blaspheme? Somebody is preaching, you question the message. And they are desperate. Have you been in any place where they are preaching and some people are saying that, don't believe that in? Have you ever had that kind of experience? Huh? That one, not my own. Please. Have you been there? I'm asking you.
Yes.
Please, yes. I know that you are looking for a very holy brother, a holy sister. You have not committed any sin. Very good. Have you been around where people challenge a message of a house?
Oh, yes.
It is not there. It's in the scriptures. It happened in the days of Jesus. It's right in the text. That's the text. And they did not challenge you from outside. They were rightly seated. And then they are challenging the message of the house. Why Papa talk so? Why did Pastor talk so? He just said he let go today. You let the man not backslide there. Should I go me? Should I go? Should I stop preaching?
No.
Is it my word?
No.
Is it not here?
Yes.
I'm just interpreting what's in the text. They said, what? The first thing, what is he saying? That's the first question. Number two, why does he blaspheme? You know, what is he saying? What is he saying? If I didn't talk sense.
Yes.
It looks like I didn't preach past the man there. If they put me for there. Because the New Living Translation said teachers. That means a person has a small level of knowledge.
Right
on. Then for them to call you a teacher, that means you have a little ability to instruct. You understand? Huh? You don't like what I'm preaching, right?
I should go.
Where are they? All these people I'm calling, where are they? No, say they are in the house of God. Please don't preach what I'm not said. I don't know who has gone and who has not gone. I came just to preach a simple word of God and go me. And let him that has ear. Seated in the house of God. The house of God has order. He says Jesus Christ is the head. To him that descended is he that ascended. And gave these gifts, Ephesians 4:11. The apostle, the prophet, the evangelist, the pastors, the teacher, that means church government, church administration, church leadership. If you are not very careful, you'll be misled by this group of people I'm talking now. Anytime you see someone challenging a message from the house and on the altar, I'll tell you what to do with the person. I'm coming soon. Let me finish my characteristics. they know so much, so nobody can teach them again. Aaron could speak so well in eloquency. He's the elder brother of Moses. Aaron could speak so well, very eloquent. But why did God choose Moses, who was a stammerer, to lead Israel? The choice of God are not the choice of men. They are not the choice of men. You think that God did not know that one day people can influence Aaron, and then Aaron will make an idol and then push the people into idol worship? No matter how the people mounted pressure on Moses, he never gave them the heart desire. According to man, everybody can elect Aaron to be the best leader because he could speak so well, so fluently. God picks people that have stamina for him. When you are behind people, and God has placed you to look up to people, and you have the privilege that God has raised you to leadership, you have to be very careful. That's the most challenging zone you're inside. To go far, save your leadership. You are next online. When the appointed time comes, God will pick you. God will do what? Pick you. God has never picked a man that was never under authority to use the person for change. God has never picked any man for influence that was never under authority. Esther was under the hand of Mordecai. God used her to redefine and rewrite the laws of an entire empire. John, James were in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending the nets. Matthew chapter 4, 19 to 21. John, James, who wrote the end times, the book of Revelation. Where was he? When Jesus found him, where? He was under authority. Elisha, he told Elisha, Elisha told Elijah, let me go tell my parents and my family members goodbye and come and follow you, because he knew he was under authority. Any person who did a great work for God and fulfilled destiny in a grand style was under authority. The proof that you are a leader is that you are under authority. There were 12 people who were under the leadership of Jesus before they became great voices. Everywhere you see people making great waves, were under authority. In church, there is a church government. In the house of God, there is leadership. No matter who you are, no matter your gifts, no matter your eloquency, honor the one God has put in front of you is the pathway to your blessing in that house. Am I talking to somebody here?
Yes.
Am I talking to someone here?
Yes.
You are not there to criticize. They blasphemed. Why? Why is he blaspheming? They challenged the message. How? People who challenge the message of a house can't go well. Please ask it anywhere. Even in Bible days, it was never well with them. Out of Bible days, it has never been. Never think that in the church of God you are never going to have the scribes, the Pharisees, the religious leaders. They are always going to be there. Sitting. People can so self-exalt themselves to a level where they think they have known God so much that now they are challenging the people who taught them the Bible. Now they are challenging the people who showed them the truth. When they were so blind, they knew nothing. And then they start turning and start forming small camps. And they are discussing leaders, discussing the head of the house, discussing the other leadership of the house, discussing the church of the house. Nobody needs to pray for you. God will come for you. It's God that placed them there, right? When Saul, in the name Apostle Paul, was running after the Christians, the apostle to bring them and bind them. Who went after Paul? Who went after him? Did you ever hear that the apostles were praying that God should go and arrest Paul? They never prayed. God went after him. He said, I am Jesus whom thou persecuted. Was he persecuting Jesus? Was beginning Jesus' representative? His government, his leadership, he has placed. God knows how to fight his battles. I'm talking to you, I'm talking to any leader who is here. Don't fight a fight for God. It's not your place. Never fight a fight that belongs to God. Never fight a fight that belongs to God. God knows how to best fight his fight. There were religious leaders in their house, and their job was to criticize what is coming, the altar. Their job is to criticize the priests and leadership serving on the altar. They miss the focus and they lose it. The next thing, what does a religious leader do? They cause divisions. They cause fragments in the house of God. Fractions, camps. They start gathering people, looking for people. Whole small meetings, fractions in the house of God. They start getting other people to believe. They are blasphemers. They start teaching a new doctrine. They start doing some things like this and that. Fractions. Anywhere you see divisions and fractions in the house of God, in a vision, in the ministry, in an assignment, the hands of religious leaders are involved inside. What do you do with them? Romans chapter 16. I want somebody who has a mic to stand up and read that scripture fast, please. Who is blessed here? Huh? 16:17. Get there. Let's read it. Let's go. Please, I want someone. Let me read. Let me read my version. The NASB. Now I urge you, brethren, keep your eye on those who cause dissensions, one, and hindrances, contrary to the teaching which you have learned. Say contrary to the teaching.
Contrary.
I'm not getting you. Say contrary to the teaching.
Contrary.
Romans 16:17. Are there people who can teach contrary to the teachings? Yes. Now the Apostle Paul, did he experience people trying to teach contrary teachings in his days? Yes. In his attempt to be planting churches in Rome and different places, did he experience people who rose up within the same church start teaching contrary things? Yes. Where? In the house of God. Let's hold it there. Are you there? Can you read the King James Version?
Now, I beseech you, brethren, mark them.
Say mark them.
Mark them.
I can't hear you. Say mark them.
Mark them.
Let me write down. If I hear you in the dark some way, what should I do to you?
Mark
you. Though you're inside God, he has what to do?
Mark you.
Look at your place. If I mark you, don't be angry.
Mark you, don't be angry.
I have a permission to do what?
Mark
you. A permission to do what?
Mark
you. Papa said, hey, the word of God says we should do this, and you are trying to do it your own way. What should I do with you?
Mark you.
Because you're trying to do something contrary to what I have been taught. What should I do?
Mark.
My version says keep an eye on them. King James says what?
Mark.
Now me I talk am. Keep going ahead.
Mark them which cause divisions.
So when you see that they're causing division, carrying members this way, carrying a brother this way, carrying people, what should you do with them?
Mark them. And offenses.
They are always taking offense or causing offenses. Bible says you should do what with them? Go ahead.
Contrary to the doctrine.
The doctrine means teachings, patterns of the house.
Which ye have learned.
Which you have learned. They are trying to unteach you. They are trying to unteach you from what you've been taught. Unteach you. They tell you to attack men of God anyhow, you attack them, you die early. When the judgment is coming, you will not miss you. Who told you that Absalom died alone? Absalom died with people. Bible says the people followed Absalom in their innocence, but yet God did not spare. When the arrows of God is coming, it does not mean you alone. In Numbers chapter 12, Korah did not die alone on the rebellion. Almost about 2,000 people, they came up and they died. There were three people in front that caused the rejection. That started the rebellions. Is it Satan alone in Revelation chapter 12 that was casted out of heaven? One third of the angels went down with him. Because any rebellion, anybody who associated with it, follows the judgment. Anybody who goes, heaven does not take play with these things in the house of God. God does not play with them. It is one of the greatest sins to God. See, when God anoints a man or a woman and places it to you as a head, pray for the person. Get your blessings. The same anointing that could bless people will still turn a more problem to your own life. I have learned for 17 years never to talk to an authority. Whether it's in the Bible, in the church, or even my biological father and mother. I didn't say I am 17 years. I'm 39 years. My eyes opened 17 years ago. I learned that you can't talk to an authority. Whether it's an uncle, a whoever, or whatever. You can't talk to a standing authority in the house. I have learned. And it's a doctrine I have taught many people who are so excelling in life today. God is opening to them. For those who hearken to the doctrines and teachings, they don't have struggle. Go and see anywhere a young man is struggling, they are playing with authority. Easy way to success, just know how to. Jesus humbled to the hands of his mother. He said it in John chapter 12. Don't judge Luke chapter 2 when he was 12 years of age. Don't you know I must be after my father's business? The mother, a son is telling you that he or she must be after his father's business. The parents took under the parental authority. They took him. Bible says they kept him for 18 years. Let me say you want to preach, you don't preach for 18 years. When you tell God, say, me, your every bad parents on the earth have shut your mouth for 18 years. They disappear him on stage for 18 years. And heaven stood quiet. Heaven does not play with standing authorities on the earth. saying? They said, we know your call, we know heaven wants to do business with you, but we, your authority, we have seen that you are not mature here for public exposure. We have seen by the routines of scriptures that any Hebrew child enters into preeminence at the age of 30. David, 30, he became king. Joseph, 30. And all the names, 30. We will process you, empower you, train you till you enter the maturity to carry that assignment. Today we have children that they don't just want to submit to be trained, they want projection, they want exposure. Early exposure, early summarization. And some of them will disappear soon. That's why people are selling powder and oil today. That's why they are using all kinds of strange things, because they did not wait for power. Can you imagine the disciples? Jesus came into ministry at the age of 30, died at the age of 33 and a half years, trained the disciples for 3.5 years. Can you imagine that the first year, the disciples said, "My Papa, please, we won't follow you for 1 year, leave him, we'll go here, we're not ready for, we're not right." Can you imagine that the day that he sent them, the Bible says, Luke chapter 10, he sent them 70 out, they returned and said, "The demons were subject to us, we have done everything," and they said, "Please, we're not right, please release me from ministry. Now so we can cast devils. Now we are ready for ministries. Now we have the anointing. Now we can." Can you imagine? There was a dimension of power they had not yet seen. There's a dimension of glory they had not yet seen. Because early experience in spiritual things does not mean you've arrived. Fathers always know. It was in the last statement, Jesus said, "Tarry until the power came." That means what power was he first of all giving them? It's called internship power. Internship power, internship power, internship power. It's power for internship. It's not the real power for your glory. It's not the real power for your manifestation. It's not the real power for exposure and announcement. Today, young people come around God. We show them small light, and we are preparing them to see loyalty. They think that they have arrived. Young leaders, young children. No, there is a level. Can you imagine they told Jesus that the person God sent you to look over or look up to or in the church, they have a pattern that they know that when they prepare you through that pattern, by the time they present you to the crowd, you are a fire. By the time they present you, you are ready for your generation. By the time they present you, you are ready for the world. Am I talking to somebody here?
Yes.
Okay, let me make it this way. Look at. When Jesus was at the age 30, he came under John the Baptist. And John the Baptist dipped him on water. The voice said, "This is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. If not, hear the way to hear him." Yes, he's a child of God, but he's not ready to be heard. He's at the age 30, but he's not ready to be heard. At the transfiguration, "This is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased, hear him." The father knows when the son is ready to be heard by a generation, by the church, by bombing. See, they're not giving me exposure. It's not yet your time to be heard. In Galatians chapter 4, it says, "It's time. As long as a heir, as long as he's a child, differed not from a slave." Right?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
And what is it? "Until the time appointed of the father is placed under tutor, governors, until the time appointed of the..." There's an appointed time for exposure. There's an appointed time for exposure. Please, leadership. When your time comes, no man can hide it. No man can fight you. And it's also dangerous to self-project yourself when you're not ready. I call it self-projection. It's also dangerous to self-qualify yourself, because every king is made of a kingmaker. Everybody is appointed to an office. There is a hand that commissioned you. There is a hand that ushers you into the pulpit. The Bible says, John the Baptist said to the world, "Behold the Lamb of God." There is always a hand that ushers you to preserve you. God will always use a hand and release you into manifestations.
Amen.
hear visions and revelations. Why did God not speak to Moses that the way you are leading these people is wrong? The way you are doing this, your government and everything is wrong. Jethro came one day, sat down, and look how Moses, Exodus chapter 18, was judging the people. He said, what you are doing is not good. And then he gave him counsel. Means no matter how you hear God, no matter how you see God, there are things God will use people to pass it to you. And until those things come, you will see fail even though you hear God. Even though you saw God, you will see fail. You fail. Am I talking to someone here?
Yes.
Mark them. Okay. Do you have the Message Bible? Who has the Message Bible in here? Give him the mic. First, please read the Message Bible. Romans chapter 16, verse 17.
One final word of counsel. Friends, keep a sharp eye out for those who take bits and pieces of the teaching that you learn and then use them to make trouble. Give these people a wide berth.
Give it to my brother to read. You should give him your phone. Take him your phone and read it, please. When you have the punctuation, stay on the punctuation. Go ahead.
Romans 16, 17, I read. One final word of
one final word of what?
Counsel.
Look at your neighbor, say one final word.
One final word.
So I know that you have been in the house of God for so long.
I know that you have been in the house of
God. The one final word.
The one final word.
Of counsel.
Of counsel.
Go ahead.
Friends.
Give a sharp eye.
Out for those.
Take the mic closer to your mouth.
Keep a sharp eye out for those who take bites and pieces of the teachings that you learn, and then use them to make trouble.
They use it to do what?
Make trouble.
They use it to make trouble. Am I the one who wrote it?
No.
Give these people a wide berth.
Are you getting it? You are getting it?
Yes,
sir. You are getting the scripture. Am I the one who said it?
No.
Can you read just the amplified version? Thank you. Give us the amplified.
I appeal to you, brethren, to be on your guard concerning those who create dissensions and difficulties and cause divisions in opposition to the doctrine, the teaching which you have been taught. I warn you to turn aside from them, to avoid them.
Say turn aside.
Turn aside.
And do what?
Avoid them.
What should you do?
Avoid.
Can I say something?
Yes.
Social distance is permitted in the kingdom. In the house of God. What is he doing? I know you took your. Am I the one who wrote it? I know you know God more than me. And you have learned God more than me. Avoid them. Am I the one who say you should avoid? I'm just giving a reported speech. Avoid them. Physically avoid them. Maybe on phone, mobile, or WhatsApp. Avoid them on Facebook. Avoid them. Have nothing to do with them. Anyone, take your time. Take your time. Don't allow somebody to play. You came here to see Jesus. That's what I told you, right? Do you know that the same place that the people are criticizing the message, the power of God was present to heal? Others were coming in that same house and getting miracle. The paralyzed man is being healed on the same message you are criticizing. A paralyzed man is receiving an impossible miracle on the same thing you are criticizing. So if you are not receiving, check yourself. Because others are coming and they are receiving on the same altar, you are criticizing it. On the same altar, the same message, you are blaspheming it. Someone is coming from behind you. You were seated already. The people are coming from behind you and receiving from the same altar that you said. Others are getting blessed on the same altar, the same message that you are saying they blaspheme. The same message that they are blaspheming has power to resurrect, to lift up a lame man from his feet. Say amen.
Amen.
Yesterday I gave you a testimony here. I knew some of my sons were here. They don't know the person, the testimony I was talking about. Where I was living here to go preach. The person in that meeting, people were there. And I lifted the person for that testimony. Of somebody receiving a visa without going with documents. Did you go here physically? Well, you know that you saw the young man testifying physically. I called him to come. Testifying, receiving a miracle visa without going with documents. Amazing grace. Strange God. Now people who give testimony that never happened. Because they just want to cajole the crowd. I don't have that kind of place. I'm too busy for that. I will not scan if I want to start talking testimony. I don't know whether I'm able to carry it. But this is my testimony service. Let's talk about. Mark them. Keep an eye on them. A sharp eye on them. Avoid them. And all that. Find that kind of person causing division. What should you do?
Avoid social distance.
Social distance, spiritual distance. Spiritual what?
Distance.
Because they want to pollute your spirit. They want to pollute your inner man. Your connection, they want to blow it. And it will affect you. What you give your ear to, you become. Unconsciously, you become. Number three, the paralyzed man. Was a paralyzed man also in the house? He was brought to the house, right? The house of God has a lot of paralyzed people. To the text, the man we had there had a physical paralysis. In other words, a deformity that rendered him unable to work, unable to walk. He could not walk. There are people in the house of God who have different paralysis. Some people come to the house of God, they are paralyzed by one side of their health. They have health issues and they cannot walk effectively. Some people have financial paralysis. They came to the house of God broke, and therefore many things they want to do is not going. They want to walk, they want to do some things, but they can't do it. Some people come to the house of God with paralyzed marriages, either living together before they came to know God, either having a child with a man before knowing God. Are you here? Am I talking to somebody here?
Yes.
The house of God is a hospital. I said it already there. People enter with diverse problems. that have rendered them dysfunctional, unable to effectively perform certain tasks and certain things. I told you some people come, they are paralyzed emotionally, paralyzed in different ways, paralyzed academically, come with nothing, no skill, nothing. They are sitting there with different problems. Some people enter, mother is dead, no, parentally paralyzed. Mother gone, father gone. Some people are there with one parent and the other ones, they don't know them. But they all enter well. Shout to me better. Why did they enter? My daughter, can you stand up? You're too young for your age, for speed. When I was growing up in your years, your age, when you make like this, they just put you stand up. This pastor, they sent to where I was when I came here at the university, the pastor lived with me. I have not died that year, I'll never die again, God. The other people allowed me to say no God for at least 5 months before the pastor entered my house. It would have been better, at least I would have been strong. I just know the Lord. It did not take long. One pastor, the pastor transferred, there was no house yet for the pastor. And I had to live with the pastor. And the pastor was an intercessor, prayer pastor. Pastor says, I did not die, I will not die again. Hi. Jesus. I mean when I'm telling you, I learned how to pray one for prayer, not because of willingness, also by the force of association. That pastor prays from 10 to 4 a.m. Sleep for 2 hours, you wake up and do morning prayer. Then sometime at midnight, we have to go around the street of Suwa because he was taking over the land. Land, they call it territorial preservation, territorial takeover. And we're going to pray at the various junction of the city, the town, and all that. We'll dress very well, we track you, and we're praying this prayer sometimes, praying at midnight. You think that we are walking on the street, but we're praying. Sometimes we're at 11, we're praying, and finish, and return back, and enter warfare, leave back contact. Sometimes I'm sleeping, you don't pray alone. You're sleeping in the air, you're praying. Once he just knows that I'm trying to toast up, he just speaks to me. I am sleeping in the air, prayer is going. As I did not die by your mother, I learned prayer to the hard way. I'm telling you the truth. I will never forget this issue of my life. But I learned prayer to the hard way. Midnight prayer, intercession prayer. That man can pray me for 11 hours and has not taken a break. Consistently without break. Sometimes I might be praying in language, then that might pray in tongues. Pray in tongues. He said that you don't make my voice, pray for me. Papa. This is a sound spiritual slap in the doctrine of where I was trained. He said that you just pray, you cannot make. You are yawning well. You don't know where to yawn. You are yawning well. Where are you yawning? Where are you yawning? You did not check yourself before meeting the person. I learned prayer through the hard way. Am I speaking to somebody here?
Yes.
I'm preaching, I have an all night. From 6 p.m. to the next day, I'm driving off to Boya. That's why I told you I will have this meeting this morning. I'm leaving here, go back and all night, standing. For 3 good days, I'm going to be preaching outside. Morning, afternoon, evening, all night. Those people have to hear their skin that they don't know what they call supernatural strength of God. They don't know it. You have to rise up. There are all these kinds of people in the house of God that comes. Am I talking to somebody else?
Yes.
So never see the house of God as a perfect place. God allowed them to come so that they can be transformed. God allowed them to come so that their lives can get better. God allowed them to come so that through the hearing of the word, the preaching of the word of God, this transformation can be doing what? Taking place. Until one day, yeah, brother that was living with the sister, I would say, no, I don't want to live with this sister again. You want to say, no, I want us to go do our traditional marriage. I want us to go do our court marriage. I want us to do bless our marriage. You find people just getting transformed and all that. These are people we have in the house of God. Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
I told her anytime I pick a point, I'll give you a solution.
Yes, sir.
If you fall, do you know the solution to the man who is paralyzed? He allowed himself to the hands of other people to lead him. Is it difficult for you? What did he do?
He allowed himself.
The four people were carrying him and going. When they met the crowd blocked. The people said, we'll take you through the roof. You know what it means to carry a man and throw him through the roof? That's the thing the man would have said. No, it was his leg that was paralyzed. It wasn't his mouth. In other words, he has the ability to object the leadership of the people that were leading him. But he still submitted to the leadership of the people. The problem with many paralyzed people in the house of God is that they are too alive to be led. Allow people to lead you in between Jesus, you, your situation, and Jesus are some people who have to help you get there. You're not getting it? What did I say? In between you, the paralyzed man, and Jesus, there are people whom God needs to use to bring you there. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes.
Where are the people in the house of God? You allow them to lead you to where your miracle is. Before you know, your paralysis will leave you. There are some people who will just carry. Look at it. The Bible says when Jesus saw their faith, which faith? The faith of the former. The faith of other men can carry your situation.
Yes.
Many people have come to me, I didn't have money to give them, but my faith could carry their destiny.
Yes, sir.
I know what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir.
Are you hearing me? I know children that came to me broke, came around me, I started ministry with no money, nobody had 100,000 or 500,000 or 50,000. But I picked them from scratch and my faith carried their future to where they are today.
Amen.
And God is still bringing many. I've told them, don't bother about your life. My faith can carry your future.
Yes.
My faith can carry your destiny.
Amen.
You know, I was not talking to you, the young man behind there. I think 5 days ago I called to my office, right? What did I tell you? I said, don't bother to think. Don't bother to bother about your life or thinking. Allow that aspect for me. Just allow me to make the decision. Let's see who is who. I have made it for 16 years on people, and I know where they are today.
Amen.
And let's watch what happens to you in 36 months from today.
Yes.
From the day I spoke to you, I know what I'm talking about. I know what I'm talking about.
Oh, yes.
We need people in church who can carry others by their faith.
Amen.
The house of God in between the paralyzed man and Jesus, where the miracle was, were some four technical people. Allow your life for some people to carry you. Do you know why they are struggling? Because you have not allowed some people to carry you. You are struggling with marriage, struggling with other issues in your life. You do know. You listen to nobody talking to you. You listen to nobody on instruction or counsel. So you're suffering. When there are potential people standing who can just make a statement and your life moved. Who can just make a phone call and your life moved. Who can reach into a place and they say, here, and your life moved. But you know what? You don't want them to lead you. What I'm talking about, especially those who have problems, who came to the church of God with problems, who came to the house of God with issues, and every day my life, every day my house, every day my home, every day my school fees, shut up! Submit to leadership. Submit to leadership. Submit to the leadership of some men to lead your life, some women to lead your life, to lead it. Am I talking to somebody?
Oh, yes.
The man, the paralyzed man allowed the people, they carry him now, the way like that. When they saw the cloud, the lame man would have never known how to dodge the cloud. A lame man, can he dodge the cloud?
No, sir.
But he dodged the cloud by submitting himself to the hands of people. Would he have been able to climb the roof?
No.
He climbed the roof through the hands of some people. It is not because you have problem. Your problem is that you have refused to leave yourself in the hands of people who can carry you. You refuse to leave yourself in the hands of some people who can carry you financially, carry you spiritually, carry you intellectually, carry you in skill, carry you in talent, carry you in counsels, carry you in advice. And that's how your life will begin to climb. I pray if there's anyone here, let this word of God meet you where you are.
Amen.
If there's anyone watching me from anywhere, someday, let this word of God reach out to you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
One of my son, you met him, yes, he's doing your stuff over there. He's about 10 years today. You met me in 2010. 2010. He's 2010, you started living with me in Africa, right? 2010. He's not my biological brother, he's not born up by blood or whatever. He's by the gospel. We met by the gospel. By the gospel. By the gospel, I went to Boya to plant on a branch 2009, 2000, the ministry's branch, and 10. And I met him. When I met him, everything had fallen apart. He was at the public work school in Boya. I missed it. And I took him. And he was with me. I was living in a house where I had one chair. One plastic chair, it's a plastic chair, right? And a small carpet. I went there sitting. I just got married. I not got married with a car. Down Miami now. And some of you want to marry, you want to marry Kaya. Instead of marrying a man. You want to marry a story building instead of marrying a person. I'm sorry, I will talk and pass. To him that has ears.
Yeah.
I had just certificates and gone out of school, and that's all me. And if somebody has to doubt my result, he was there when I started. My marital journey. We came. Before God and before man, there's nobody. You know, there's nobody I've seen, and maybe the best I saw was his mother. I saw the mother once. No other person in the family has ever come before. I took him to my own younger man, I took him to my own younger brother. I said, let me make the decision with him. Started. On the journey. The journey is there. Looked at him, I said, you go to the university. Send him to the University of Bamenda by the help of God. When they finish, go do a master's. Why? He's not making, something happened. In this period, I came to do master's. I don't know what happened. I wish life always happened. He said to me, somebody told him what about to go and work somewhere. I was praying somewhere, the Lord said to me that your son is not in my bed. He said, how God can prophesy sometimes, the Holy Spirit can speak to you. The Holy Spirit spoke to me in the place of prayer. I was in the altar praying. The Holy Spirit spoke to me that your son is not in Bamenda. I said, where is he? He said, he's not in Bamenda. He's out of place. In Davin.
Out of place.
I called him. And those my simple calls are simple. I don't say anything. Good morning. Where are you? You know, when heaven asks you that kind of question, Adam! Where are you? You know, there's a question when they ask you, how to start calling your house.
I'm in your possession.
See, let me tell you, I love the voice of God, but I don't like question from heaven. To be honest to you, I don't like when heaven asks you a question. Don't answer, just ask scan your life.
Ah.
That's something I don't like. That he had done so is either unbelievers can. Moses spoke, God said, what is in your hand? That means there are some things you are either missing in place. Because someone tell me, maybe, where is that working? Or maybe he said, well, I'm in this place. I'm in Nelo now. I came to look for a job. I said, I'm going to look for a job. Where you are, start turning back to the place where you came from. Back to the same place and stay there. That's life. That's what I'm talking about. Maybe I don't feel like I was talking about the understanding. Let me talk about practical senses. Because the problem is that many people have problems and don't allow people to meet them. They have issues. This life is worked out. This one's life is worked out. I have opportunities in and out of the countries that don't even go. And then he's reading what I read in the university. I read economics. I don't like economics. He's reading economics. Some of you who are educationists here, whatever. I'll publish paper and put his name once he has a master's. That's co-authoring. You know it very well. And then he will go out of the country and then present in different scientific papers. He said, he will be struggling. I have the time I'm preaching. In different places he can go. His life is already wired. Whatever he's looking for is already set on ground. There's nothing. What is he looking for again? And now, stupid voice, go work for Melon. Now, in the whole Cameroon, is Melon a city? What is notable about Melon? Those fruits, and the oil and the meat. What is significant around the corridor? At least if you are from Melon, I'm not insulting your city. Forgive my sins, I might be talking around the business. But I'm just trying to talk in relation to impact. And some few things. There is a town in Cameroon, where somebody entered and said maybe something is around that town. We call Douala. Maybe there are some big estates and companies, conglomerate, multinational institutions or whatever. They may not. Wait a minute. You really be wish my son to be around them. I'm not saying this for anything to relate to. I'm just trying for a lesson. You two can face it. I have to forgive you. To move on. It can happen to you. You will need to show mercy. But the problem we have is that many people have problems or issues around their life are not submitted to be carried. Other people's faith can bring you to your amazing miracles. Other people carrying you can push you to some place you never believed you would be there in your entire life. Never believed. So I'm giving the cure. Your issue is not your problem. It's just your willingness to surrender your will so that other people can carry you to where your destiny is. Don't live a life where no one can talk to you. And I always tell people, never marry a girl that no man can talk to her and she hears. You are married a sword. Any woman that nobody can talk to, her, never marry her. I have said this for many years. I love my children. Never marry a man that no man can talk to him. You are married premature death. If you doubt it, when you have time home, read 1 Samuel chapter 25. You will hear of a woman called Abigail. She got married to a man called Nabal. Bible said the man was so rich. But the one thing that was known, he says, and the servant said, don't mind that man, for no man can talk to him. He was rich, oh. But the problem was that no man, and therefore he died early. So marrying a man that no man can talk to is prepared to be a widow soon. If you have a problem with your man, who will you talk to that can talk to you? It's 10 years today, maybe a few months from today, December, will be 10 years in marriage. We never had a problem that my mother, my marriage father ever came to my house. But we had some disagreements with my wife or something about 3 times. And she has to talk to my spiritual father. My spiritual father talked to me and I had to listen to myself together. Then my spiritual father advised me and probably maybe I refused not to. Then my wife is too. She'll be crying every day. Am I talking to somebody here?
Oh, yes.
Are you getting me?
Oh,
yes. I'm talking to you. Somebody talk to me. Somebody can say, hey, Peter, why are you? Come here. Maybe if I hear the call to, I start shaking. Say, why is daddy calling me? What am I doing? What I was in Yaoundé, I went to preach. And I was in Kabila. Where I was lodging, there was a supermarket close opposite the hotel. I went to the supermarket. I was buying things. Suddenly my phone rang. My son, where are you? So I'm asking, where are you? You're not the first time. They have asked me to. Then I turned. And they said, go and change. But I asked, why is he seeing me? I went in the Kabila now. Just from the hotel to go buy something, go and change. And I'm looking around, who's reporting me from anywhere.
Yeah.
I'm not seeing anybody, go and change. Am I speaking to someone else?
Yes.
Allow your life to be balanced. Allow your life to be what? Finally, the four men. The last character is what? The four men. Let me explain the four men. In the church, you're going to have the four men. And this is where I want everybody in the house of God to be part of. The four men who carry the paralyzed man. The four men. Number one, the four men have a mission to carry people to Jesus. Be in the house of God to help people see Jesus. Be in the house of God to help people meet with what? Jesus. That's the first thing. You're in the house of God to help people assess Jesus. You are in the house of God to help people assess Jesus. Meet with Jesus. Encounter Jesus. Encounter the God of the church. Encounter the Jesus of the church. Encounter Jesus. Number two. The four men does not believe, they don't believe in impossibilities. To see a lame man and believe that he can be healed, then you have to do it. Am I talking to somebody here?
Yes.
They don't believe that any situation is hopeless. You are in the house of God to believe. Believe. I like to be the Christian who has belief, who has faith, who believe in possibilities. The four men were people that believe in what? Possibilities. Say possibilities.
Possibilities.
I can't hear you say possibilities.
Possibilities.
To see a lame person with the deformities and believe that the person can walk again, then you believe in what? Possibilities. In this church, people enter here that their business have crumbled on the ground, and you can believe that they can bounce back. They don't need to meet the pastor. They need to meet you at the door, and you greet them with a smile. I say, I see hope coming to your life. When they talk to you, say, sister, you don't know me, or my life, tell the person that your life has hope. Am I talking to somebody here?
Yes.
Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes.
So as you see me like that, my own don't finish, tell the person that your life is about to start.
Yes.
You need that kind of people in the church of God. Men and women of faith. Men and women of what? Possibilities. Who see possibilities in every dead situation? Possibilities in every desperate case, desperate matter, desperate issue, dead situations, that they are able to see life in the situation. Life in the situation. Someone enters here with an HIV and looks so depressed, tell the person that God can heal HIV. There is a cancerous infection, kidney problem, tell them that Jesus can heal them in this house. Am I talking to somebody here?
Yeah.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Number three, what did the four people have? They believe in the power working miracle God. They believe in the miracle power of God. You need men and women who believe in the power of God. Who believe in the miracle working power of our God. They believe that there is a power at the altar to heal the lameness of the man. They believe there was a power on the altar to heal that man. They believe that there was a power in the place where Jesus was. If we can make sure that man falls at the presence of God, the presence of Jesus, Bible says where the presence of God is, there is liberty. If that man can fall at the presence of Jesus, that situation cannot remain normal. If this man can fall at the presence of Jesus, change will come. And they were carrying that man to fall at the presence. Do you believe in the power of God? Are you the one talking people down off the house of God? Are you the one making people feel like their situations are hopeless? Bible says the apostle Paul speaking the other days in the book of Romans, I am not afraid of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, for it is the power unto salvation to them that believe. It is the power, the power, the power, the power, the power, the power, the power. It is the power, it is the power. He himself speaking in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, he said, for the preaching of the gospel is foolishness unto them that are perishing, but unto us who believe, it is what? The power of God. It is the power of God. It is the power of God. It is the power of God. For the kingdom of God is not in words only, 1 Corinthians 4 verse 20, but it is the power of God. The power of God. The power of God. You tell the person, I don't care what others have said concerning your life, but God has the final say. I don't care what people have said, but Jesus has the final say. Your situation is not helpless until God concludes on it. Your situation remains hopeful until Jesus. When Jesus is present on the subject, when Jesus is still speaking on the subject, I don't care if everybody has died in your life. Everybody died, the test has still happened. The father died, the mother died, because she could still become a queen. Her destiny was not buried. Joseph was in a foreign land, left mother, left father, left brothers and sisters in prison to the palace. We serve a God of miracles. And it is going to be so dangerous to have Christians that do not believe that this God is still in the business of miracles. I serve a God who is mighty. I serve a God who is mighty. you, number one. I just want you, I have spoken from a vast angle. The word of God has come to you from every point. I just want you to kneel down and talk to God. Where the word met you, where am I failing? Am I the scribes? Am I one of the religious leaders? Am I in the crowd? Am I in the crowd? Am I out of a situation? But have I been fighting my own will and I'm still where I am because I have not known how to release myself in the hands of other four people to carry me where my future can go? Am I the one limiting my own life? Am I the one keeping myself where I am today? It's my attitude and character. It's my approach seeking me. Am I helping many to know God, to see Jesus and to follow them? Am I helping people? Do I believe in the power of God? Do I believe in the God of possibilities? Do I believe in the God of miracles? There is mercy on this altar.
confidence. When you lose your desire, then today I'm picking up the anointing of the format. The anointing of the format. This year, from today, I will carry people into the glory of God, the presence of God.
If we can only look where God brought us from, you have a reason to look at somebody and tell the person there is hope for the future. It's just that sometimes we have forgotten where we come from. We have forgotten to really look the mercy, the grace, the love of God, and the power of God working in our own life. That's why we have helped other people not to see this God. It's time to go. Jesus, so many
I'm going to go.
pianist play with you. Let the pianist play with you. Please stretch your hand on the heavens.
Thank you.
Syrian coming. And the Bible says, the servant said, Master, at last we are captured. And Elisha said, they that be for us. And later, and said, Lord, open his eyes. And he saw chariots of armies and fires everywhere. One of the proofs of the prophetic unction is the ability of your eyes to open. In Jeremiah chapter 1, and the Lord asked Jeremiah, what seest thou? He said, I see like a boiling pot and an almond tree. The eyes of a prophet is open. The ears are open. This is what two things are about to happen.
Just stay here if you are
down below, just stay here. Don't rise up, just stay here.
Yeah, I can see you.
Stay here, stay here, stay here.
Oh.
up from the sign. Get ready for me. Get ready, I'm coming for you. And the prophet Samuel poured the oil and sanctified it. Thou art anointed and chosen of the Lord. That young man is about to collapse. He'll be ruling there. Please protect him. Protect. Protect. When I say protect, I mean protect. Protect. never seen me before. Where? You saw me in Restoration Chapel once. Stretch your hand. It's not good to be seeing dead people now. It's not good to be seeing dead people now. Why are dead people wanting you? Why are you always seeing them in your dream? Have you not seen that it's consistent? You're always in a meeting with dead people. Appearing to you, talking to you. Can I have the issue? Can I give you a new dawn? Glory God.
Hallelujah, the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. will show up. And the Lord says, I will pray for her. I will pray for you. There is a power fight in your house. There is a force going on in your house. And God has to help. If God does not help, it's not working. It's not for you. Don't know. It's not for you. And I will pray for you. The children who are here, apart from the grandma who are here, they invite your entire family to come to this church and give thanks to you. You understand what I'm saying? Do it. I am facing all your children. If you tell me there is one more child, you will need to do that. You are your children.
Speaking to you now, that
that as you leave, make up your mind to live for my cause. I'll be sending children to you, and I'll be sending women to you. I'll be sending girls to you, and I'll be sending them to you. Maybe you were not conscious. I have come to speak to you in the open, that you are Elizabeth I am lifting in my house, and I want you to hold the hands. This woman, I don't know her, but the attacks that this woman has suffered, the trouble she has gone through for the work of God, it's not as been easy over the years. God says, the same way I have worked with you, I have been able to carry you through the storms. I want you to hold the hands of people. You are like one of the four people that carried the paralyzed man. There are a lot of people you are going to hold your hands to cross them. My daughter, and that is why I'm putting my hands on your life. I'm going to lay my hands upon her. Everything about her is going to change. You will serve this house and you will watch me bless you. As I have fought your battles, will I fought it more greater than you've ever seen. For I, the Lord your God, have placed my hand upon you. And nothing can change it.
Amen.
Lord, the gift of prophecy that used to operate on your life, that looks like it has gone cold. There were days I would open my eyes and show you things for you to speak them to me. For me. The Lord says, I'm restoring that grace, not like in the former, but in the latter. And the anointing will be heavy on you. Receive the grace as a channel of this house. Please, I need about two persons or three people. Not this one. Fresh fire. 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 Fresh fire, fresh fire, fresh fire, fresh, 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 fresh. And now me, in her old age, her breast milk began to flow. And she was able to give, to take care of young children.
Yay!
You thought the gift went. It is coming on a high fire. High grace! In a way you have never seen before. Fresh! Fresh! It comes like a mantle. It comes like a mantle. Like a mantle. Like a mantle. It comes. It comes. Please. It comes. Fresh fire.
I am the Lord. I am the Lord. I am the
Lord.
I
came to open the rivers. Put your hand like this.
Yes.
Say, Lord, no more.
Yes.
Say, no more.
Yes.
No more spiritual husband.
Yes.
You know what I say?
Yes.
Lord, what?
Yes.
You know what I'm speaking?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
There is this person that always comes to the life of you.
Yes.
Spiritual husband, connections, bonds, or whatever. Yes. Are you getting what I'm saying? You are hearing me very well? This thing comes and go. And once it happens, everything's now going negative in your life. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Is it true? Take two steps in front. One, two. Take the last one. Turn and look at me. Stretch your hand. Don't touch her. Don't. Anybody else, I'm going to stand behind. Stretch your hand to me. The spiritual things are different. Father, in the name of Jesus, I break that link and connection to that relationship. I destroy it now by the fire on the altar and the anointing on my head. You have kept her standing on the same position, so gifted with a lot of strength and a lot of power, that certain things are not finding expression. This morning, let that anointing arrest that force. She's going to scream. Something will leave her. And is leaving her with a scream and a shout. In the count of three. One. Yes, Lord. Two. Holy Ghost. The God of heaven sets free is free indeed. The Lord who make it alive and call it alive sets free. Set them free. Set them free. Glory to the Lord, He reigns.
We give glory to the Lord. We give glory to the Lord, He reigns.
Said
in Exodus, the scripture says that Moses' hand was held by Aaron. The Lord says, I should speak to you, that you should hold the hands of this man. Oh God. What should you do? Have you ever read the scripture I'm speaking about? I'll give you the scripture finally. You should hold the hand of this man. One time Israel had a fight. Moses went and stood on the mountain. And his hand, when he lifted up his hand, the people were winning. When his hand got tired and the hand came down, the enemy began winning the Israelites. Until two persons went and held his hands. If you are going to win in life, hold his hands. If you are going to win in life, hold his hands. The Lord is going to bless you amazingly for holding his hands. The Lord is going to bless you. I give you word of God yesterday. Except I'm not called of God. I give you word yesterday when I preach here. And I'm hearing another word saying you should hold. What does it mean to hold the hand of a servant of God? It means to make yourself available to know His words. What does it mean to hold the hand of a servant of God? To know His cry and be able to reach out to that need. The work that God has given in His hands, hold His hands. You getting it? I'm going to do a prophetic symbol. Hold one of that hand. Baba, hold that hand. Give me that one. Lift it up. That's how the scripture says. Lift it up. Father, in the name of Jesus, there are no mountains that you will not be able to suppress. There will be no mountains. Whenever these words
and man of God will proclaim words on your life, or kneel down and pray for you, the world will know. Mountains will collapse. Obstacles will be removed. Miracles will flow by this grace, and by this connection, and by this covenant. Your life will be so colorful, and everyone will remember this day that the Lord spoke a word. Things that were not working will open up for you. And many will know that the Lord has chosen you. This is not a position to stand for now. And nothing will be able to knock you down in this life. Nothing will be able to steal what belongs to you. Nothing will be able to take what belongs to you. For the work of God in your hands will not fail and will not sink, because the Lord has appointed you. No witch will touch your house. No wizard will touch your house. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Young man, please come and bind them. Come. Yes, come. 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 Stand there.
Lord God, I said yesterday I was delivering this young man from the altar. This hour, give him the zeal and the calling for ministry. Put the fire for ministry upon him. Take from my head and wear it on him. Wear it on him. Pick him up. Bring him to me. Like in the days of Pentecost, flood him with grace. Let him be overdrunk with the anointing. Anointing to preach the gospel. Anointing to totally submit to the gospel. Fire him. She's laughing. She'll get that little of laughter soon. Jesus. Give it to her. Let the fire burn. Lord, take him out from every place. Take him out from every angle. Can you help this young man married? Help him. Help him. Leave him down there, leave him down there. Leave him down there. Leave him down. About to open you a door.
Okay.
I see an open door before you. Man of God, in between now and next year, by this same time, a lot of your children in this house will be married. Yes. Lift up your hands on the air, anywhere you are. That anointing, I release it. I arrest every marital demon.
Amen.
Marital altars.
Amen.
That fight marriages in families.
Amen.
Anyone that is here, connected to that kind of altar. Let them go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Go! 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 Loose spirits of demons. Anyone connected to any altar that fights marriages and delay marriages. Scattered homes. Scattered families. Break! Break from that altar. Break from such altars. Let them go. Pray the prayer of marriage. Why did I ask you kneeling down and I'm praying the prayer of marriage? Do you know why? You know why? You don't know why? Because you are going to get married. I love it. It has never happened to you, right? Stand up. God knows how to wipe the tears of people. Nothing can change it. Nothing can scatter it.
Amen.
You will serve God with passion. You will love God with passion. The fire for the kingdom. Receive the grace of celebration. Show me loving under the anointing. Loving under the anointing. The release of grace. I release and open heavens. I know I'm scattering that. You know I pray that prayer? Because this marriage has been a battle. You know I pray that? I'm praying that any order fighting and scattering. Because you are not supposed to be getting married in October. The wedding. Why are you clapping your hands? October is not the set date you were supposed to get married. The date has been set. Cancel. Said, carry, cancel. Battles everywhere. But here like this, nothing can move that date again.
Yes.
You want to talk again? I'm suffering, yes.
I just want to confirm your prophecy.
I told you that I'll speak to you when?
Yeah.
Yesterday, what did I tell you?
That you speak to me today.
Yeah.
I just wanted to confirm your word.
That what? Talk now. Give me microphone. Smart, give me a microphone.
He said I'm a teacher, it's true. He said I'm a teacher, it's true. I'm by teacher, GHS, but okay. And then he said...
And then I was showing you in the air yesterday. You were doing married thing on the air.
Yeah. And then about marriage. It has been a very serious battle.
I know.
I used to see it, and the Lord often showed me the dates and the details, the dressing, everything. So last December, the Lord gave the date for the traditional marriage. 6 December, with the dressing, everything, and the amount of the bride price, we obeyed. Then the Lord gave us a divine restraining order to abstain till the marriage comes. And so we never put the date, but a week ago, I saw that we were preparing already, and now we had 2 months. And one of my sisters saw in October, so my auntie confirmed. But the Lord told me that when he would tell me the marital date, we will have less than 15 days to marry. So, thank you.
Give me a hand. The battles in your father's house will not tamper with your future.
Amen.
you more. This is an apostolic shift in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Did you see this house? You look around this house and you plant a sacrifice in this house for the development of God's work. No one will tell you. I will not tell you. Anchor it to assess the grace. Amen. Take care of God. Do you fellowship here now? You do. Come. Yeah. This one has finished singing. I'm talking. Give her my daughter. The ministry of singing and talking. You don't bother about, No problem. I spoke to your husband, I'll talk to him. That one is private. I said it now. I'll talk to you about marriage, right? Is it not true? I know why I said I'll talk to him. Because it's not, there's a battle. There's an, it's not easy with the marriage. That's why I said I did not want to talk in the public. The Lord spoke to me yesterday. Then we will talk. Okay? The Almighty God. Can you put your hand like this? Put it like this. Say, I want babies. Say it again. Why you look at me like that? Concerning the life of God. Now we proclaim the word of God. Are you guys thinking? Fear not. What did I say? God will work it for you. Amen? Yes, that's one of the things I wanted to talk to your husband. I don't need anybody to talk, but I wanted to talk to you on some issues. I have ministered and I have spoken to you. Are you getting me? The divine is injected in Jesus' mighty name. Affliction will not rise the second time. Where's your mother? Where's your father? Affliction will not rise the second time. You will not bury another person, okay? You hear me? Yes, your family is buried. People are dying strangely. I went to the altar. What is, are you hearing what I'm saying? I went to the altar, I saw a black cloth on you. That's why I walked straight to you. Are you getting me? And it's symbolizing death. Never ever. Thank you. that curse on the family that takes life. Wake up. People don't know that when a man of God calls you, don't come with horses. You say, wait. They don't have to receive from God. They have to be taught on how to receive God and approach the man of God. When they call you, you're coming for freedom. Catch everything on your hand. That's how your father will be preaching anytime. When they call you, you're coming with expectation to draw from the horns on the altar. You're not coming with weight on your hands. Pick her up. I had to deal with that. I just had to pull it out. God will shape you so that that spirit and things living. Are you getting me? Look at me. The fact that cloud I saw go out of her. What do you think is going on? What do you think is going on now? Huh? What do you think is going on? You know it's a black cloud, right? There is a person going out. I'm speaking in prophetic symbols, and some of you cannot understand. She's walking but carrying the face of an old person. Living inside her. Did you see? Are you seeing that? If you can stand this way, you'll see it. I show you. You see, she'll start walking like an old person. It's a bad thing. And she came here and left by that, you think, no. I just came to the altar. I want to just be a summary word. My eyes open in the realms of the spirit. In the realms of the spirit. She will need some assistance. I don't know her too much. I don't know her. And all that. Okay, let's take that one out. Father, in the name of Jesus. In the count of three. Go out of her. And let her be free completely. One. Two. Son of God sets free his free meat. He can show former hand. And it's a perfect deliverance for her. Free from her family curse and background. Is something that you need to learn it as a curse, as a child of God. It's a whole curse on its own. Operating the supernatural is a whole curse. That's all. The 10 seconds is done. Pick out now. The hope of God are not fleshy. They are not things of it. The eye is the flesh. Look at me. There is a boy, I want you to come out from that relationship. Are you getting me? There's a relationship I want you to come up from. It's not helpful to your life. It will not help you. It will not go anywhere. Did you hear what I'm saying? Huh? I'm saying this is very serious to your life. Stop that relationship. End it. Is it clear? Huh? When you have time, see the man of God, talk with him. Okay? End this relationship. Did you hear what I said? Am I lying? Huh? There is an access because we can cast out demons and then they go back. Once the platform has a problem, the same spirit comes and it looks like we were lying. We're just doing some drama here. Jesus told the woman, go and sin no more, lest a worse thing happen to you. This is an issue that I have to say it. I would have spoken to you in private, but I want to talk to you very clearly. As you leave from this meeting, make up your mind. See your man of God. Don't ask how. God will take care of you. Do you hear me? God bless you. Thank you for coming. Says, I should tell you and your wife, growth is coming to the church. Before this year comes to an end, people will be out there. Yeah. Out there. Out there. Not I speak by the voice of heaven. Yeah. And by the voice of him that called me and sent you. There is going to be a cloud out there, an overflow out there. God is about to expand this church greatly. And there will be no stress for miracles on this altar.
Amen.
The Lord says, that's the second prophecy for you and the church. First prophecy, increase is coming. Second prophecy, the dimensions of miracles. A miracle that took place in Mark chapter 2 we read. That same power will be present in this church in an extraordinary way.
Amen.
Many situations that are impossible, when people have gone from places to places, when they step in here, the God of this place will answer those situations.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The third prophecy I gave on this church is that marriage gifts are coming to this church.
Amen.
And then the fourth instruction I'm giving to people, to some of you who are leaders, if you're here, your marriage has not been blessed. There are three levels of marriages. Traditional marriage, customary marriage, civil status marriage, and church marriage. Maybe you got born again. You got married before getting born again. Or you are living with somebody and you've not blessed your marriage. Let this year, if you're a leader, not pass without you coming to do your marriage blessing. I'm asking somebody here.
Yes, sir.
Put things right in the house of God. And let Jesus be exalted, and then his blessings will flow in his house.
Amen.
To this end, I will hand the mic to your father in the house. Take these instructions as the word of the Lord, and the Lord will build his house. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.